Good afternoon. So I will be pre-recording this lecture for FST 325, which is for food quality assurance. So I will be starting with module 2, which is about process standards and statistical control. Okay, so you may pause this video anytime. You may also download it since I will be uploading it on YouTube. Okay, so the goals of this course is basically to discuss different ideas about basic concepts and principles behind TQM, or what we call the total quality management. And also, I will be presenting examples of programs that can be adopted to food industry. So if you are working in a food industry as food technologist, this course will be very helpful, and also to gain overall is an understanding of QA or quality assurance. So we have several terminologies here that you should be very much aware of, since this is quality assurance. All of these terminologies you will hear most of the time. So first, we have data quality. Data quality is basically the summary of all features that make the values appropriate for the intended use. So pag sinabi naman kasing data, no, it is compilation of documents. And then quality control, the second terminology, is operational techniques and activities that are used to satisfy the quality requirements. Okay, so next, we also have good laboratory practices. So this term means it's an organizational process and the conditions under which laboratory studies are planned, performed, monitored, recorded, and reported. So I'm sure na as my one of my students, yung nung second year kayo or nung first year kayo, you are already taught how to have this good laboratory practices, such as recording everything that you have observed, monitoring dun sa mga experiments, and syempre yung mga basics, such as kasama rin dito yung proper na laboratory na equipment natin, and what you wear, from using lab coat and using goggles, etc. Even handling the chemicals kasama rin po dyan. And of course, ang pinakang goal talaga ng quality control natin ay makapag-produce ng food composition data, no? Isang collection of data that meets the required standards, following the standards for efficient and economic production. Okay, so let's start with the scope of quality assurance program. So pag sinabi nating scope, ano ba yung nilalaman nun? Anong kasama dito? So syempre, we have three essential components of quality assurance according to Garfield. So we have the acronyms PAC or PAC. We have prevention, assessment, and correction. So ito yung mga dapat meron automatically when we're talking about quality assurance. Okay, so prevention. So let me move my camera here. Okay. So when we say about prevention, ito yung mga steps taken prior to the analysis. When we say prior, ibig sabihin before pa magkaroon ng analysis. So sabi nga, diba, prevention is better than cure pagdating sa health. So ito, it is intended to ensure na yung accuracy ng analytical testing natin will be good, ang mga kalalabasan na results, no? So for example, yan ay of course yung calibration ng ating instruments. So before we use any lab equipment, kailangan alam natin how to calibrate it para alam natin if the reading will be accurate. And we also have testing ng reagents, or kasama rin dito yung training of personnel. So important ang training of personnel kasi di ba, if you remember or from our last module, manpower is one of the most important element according to Gold and Gold. So training of personnel kasama dyan is yung paano mag-handle ng food, proper food safety, and lahat ng process, no? Kaya dumadaan ng training ang personnel. So there are times na ang mga training pwede yung gawing quarterly, pinapadala ang mga personnel, or pwedeng merong weekly basis na training. And minsan meron tayong daily na parang reminders na okay, dapat ganito gawin, ganyan, etc. So that is part of the prevention sa quality assurance. So next is assessment. So assessment, ito yung mga procedures undertaken during, no? So habang nagte-testing tayo, during testing. So this is in a present tense, ano? To determine whether the test systems are performing correctly. So for example po niyan ay ang use of standards and blanks or yung mga data sheets. And also, maintenance ng calibration chart. So, pagdating ng assessment, ito yung makikita nyo if you are recording kung ano yung previous na ginawa mo, no? And also, kung ano yung ginagawa mo at the present time. So, yeah. Next is, we have correction. So, correction, ito yung action taken to correct the system when there is an error or possible error is detected. So, ang example niyan ay pag nakita nyo na mali po yung reading, so perhaps we can do an equipment recalibration or we may replace the reagent or we may replace kung anumang equipment or machine na kailangan nating ayusin. No? So, basically yan, tatlong po yan ay very important. So, again, just a reminder that proper documentation of all activities involved, lahat ng activities, is the central feature of quality assurance program. So, without proper documentation, ang hirap i-assess ng isang system if it's working properly, no? So, kaya sa mga worksheets natin, it's important also na basic yung pagbabasa ng instruction. And also, yun dapat maging detailed kayo, no? May pagka-obsessive compulsive kayo when it comes to documenting the experiments and observations. So, in general, ginagawa sa quality assurance, excuse me, let me move this. Okay, so ginagawa sa quality assurance is the sample identity and integrity have not been compromised. So, yan ang kailangan nating siguraduhin. And the analysis is conducted by a member who is competent of the task. So, dito pag sinabi natin competent, diba may alam, no? Knowledgeable siya and skills. Meron siyang skills para gawin yung mga bagay na yun. Like, for example, sa lab, kinukuha yan usually ay mga chemist when it comes to testing, or if pwede ring microbiologist, no? So yan. And also pagdating naman sa mga product development, ang kinukuha ay mga food technologist. Okay, so what else? Yung equipment and methods natin that are used are appropriate and working properly. So when we say appropriate, ibig sabihin po nito ay perfect puzzle fitting ang mga methods and equipment. So, for example, kung ikaw ba ay magpriprito ng fish o ng kahit ano, ng poultry, ng chicken, gagamit ka ba ng oven? So, no, kasi you are frying. So, dapat deep fryer ang gagamitin. So, yun yung mga simple na equipment and method na tinatawag natin. Okay, next is, of course, the lab can demonstrate its current capability to produce a valid data. So, again, important documentation ulit yan. Okay, so next. Next is determining methods. So, ano ba yung mga methods na ginagamit to determine quality? So, there are many, no? So, sabi dito, let's move this. Okay, so sabi dito, there are many methods that are available to evaluate food samples. But the question will always be, which is right to use? So, alin ang tamang gamitin? So, methods, depending on the characteristic. So, depending on upon the characteristic of interest and kung ano yung objective ng analysis natin. So, hindi lang tayo basta-basta gagamit ng kung ano nung method, no? Kasi it may be economically, hindi siya okay kasi baka nagsasayang ka lang ng reagent or nagsasayang ka lang ng instrument, nagsasayang ka ng time mo, and a lot of resources are wasted kasi you don't know which is right to use. Okay, so there's this criteria na ginagamit for choice of methods according to Egan, 1974 pa, no? Imagine. But until now, ito pa din ang ginagamit ng ating mga studies. So, so we have three. So, unang-una, kailangan nating malaman if it's reliable. So, there is a reliability. So, ibig sabihin nito, established na merong collaborative studies involving several laboratories. So, pag reliable, ibig sabihin, napatunayan na, no? And kasama sa reliability, yung precision, accuracy, lahat ng yan, na-test na, no? Okay, so next, number two is, recommended ba siya ng international organizations such as, for example, Food and Agriculture Organization, WHO. So, yan yung mga matataas natin na international organizations. So, yan, no? So, again, number one, kung reliable ba? So, ibig sabihin, ito ay meron ng studies from different laboratories. Number two is, ito ba ay recommended or adopted ng international organizations? And of course, lastly, number three, is if yung methods ba are applicable to a wide range of food types and matrices rather than those that can only be used for specific foods. So, bakit ito kailangan? So, meron kasing mga methods po na ang mahal-mahal, no? Sobrang mahal, pero isang pagkain lang or isang type of food lang ang kaya niyang i-test. So, we have to know that if this method, pwede siya sa iba't ibang food types, no? Okay. So, we have two classifications in methods of analysis. We basically have subjective methods and objective methods. So, both of this we will be discussing throughout the semester. So, yun, alam ko, ang next module natin will be about subjective methods or, yes, I think, subjective methods. So, tingnan natin ano yung difference ng dalawa. Okay. So, I know you are very much familiar with this food item. So, itong isaw na tinatawag natin. So, nakakamiss kasi lagi ako nag-iisaw after work. So, ngayon, we are in a work from home setting. So, yung isaw po na yan. So, kung kayo po ay tatanungin, so, how would you know if this item is still okay to eat? Ibig sabihin, kung okay pa ba siyang kainin using subjective method, no? Or how about objective method? So, kung halimbawa, ako ang tatanungin, when it comes to subjective method, ito po yung true sensory evaluation. So, titignan nyo, taste, no? Taste test. So, mag-taste test kayo. And, tignan nyo, okay pa ba yung lasa? Okay pa ba yung pang-amoy niya? Based on just looking at the isaw, lutong-luto na ba siya? Hindi ba siya sobrang madaming sunog? Or, wala ba siyang kahit anong molds? or signs of microorganism, or wala ba siyang kahit anong sign na siya ay medyo panis na. So, yan ang medyo subjective method, ano? So, when we say, how about objective method? So, ito, dadaling ko siya sa laboratory para matest. So, merong mga analysis na ginagawa, no? So, that is objective method. Okay, so, tingnan natin. So, subjective method, it is based on opinions of individual evaluators. So, hindi naman, although meron tayong mga evaluators na they are very skilled and talagang pinag-aralan nila kung paano yung sensory evaluation. However, it is still a biased kind of method kasi nga based siya sa physiological reaction of different persons. So, it is consist of physiological reaction resulting from prior training experiences of the individual, the influence of personal preference, and powers of perception. So, for example, meron tayong evaluator. Sabi dito, resulting prior from training experience of the individual. So, for example, yung taong yun, tsaka ito, influence of personal preference. That person, if tayo ay magse-sensory evaluation, for example, ng tomato sauce na gagamitin or for spaghetti. However, that person, meron siyang experience from the past na ayaw niya talaga ng tomato, ayaw na ayaw niya talaga ng spaghetti sauce. So, magiging biased pagdating doon yung kanyang results, no? What else? Powers of perception. Perhaps, maybe yung taong yon, yung nag-evaluate na yon ay hindi siya attracted sa color red kasi ang favorite color niya ay orange. So, ang gusto niya, mas orange yung kulay ng spaghetti, no? So, ganyan. May mga factors na nangyayari sa subjective method. Okay, what else? Here, subjective method, his or her opinion to qualitative or quantitative values. So, minsan, pagdating sa qualitative, yun nga, yung again, use of your senses, the flavor, odor, color, even the touch, or yung texture, makikita natin dito. So, when it comes to quantitative values, for example, if that person, ang opinion niya is dahil mahina talaga siya kumain, so maybe, ganito lang kadami dapat ang nakalagay sa spaghetti sa isang lalagyan, ano? So, yung isa naman, perhaps, baka, for him or her, yung quantity na yon ay kulang pa. So, yan. So, iba-iba. So, this method may also be called as sensory methods. So, kasi nga, we use mostly the senses such as flavor, odor, color, touch, etc. Okay, so now we compare it with objective methods. So, ito naman si objective method, it is based on recognized standard scientific test. So, when we say standard scientific test, ibig sabihin, meron na tayong comparison, no? And also, when we say standard, repeatable na siya. So, based on studies. Okay? And it is applied to sample of the product. Okay? So, there is three general groups here. We have physical method, chemical methods, and microscopy methods. Okay, so sa three groups of objective method. So, si physical method, this is the quickest method for quality evaluation. So, and it requires the least amount of training kasi dito sa physical method, you basically have just the physical inspection comparing to a standard. So, for example, meron tayong pinaka-basic na sa fruits. No? So, let's just say we have an apple. So, sa physical inspection, pag nakita niya sa receiving pa lang na color green yung apple, pero ang standard ay color red na apple, so reject na po yun agad, no? So, what else? If the apple have bruises, So, may mga kaunting sugat yung ating mansanas. So, automatically, that is rejected. Ano? May mga ganyan. So, what else? A physical method. Okay, i-discuss naman pala. Okay? So, dito, what else? A chemical method naman, it is a quick test or possible din na it may be a long procedure. Comparing with physical methods, si chemical method is much more accurate. It gives off much more accurate values. And the results are usually in quantitative values, so numerical. And then, the last group is the microscopy method. So, si microscopy, ito ay much technical personnel ang kailangan. And use of microbiology to study the sample. Okay, so first we have the physical method. So sabi ko nga kanina, ito tinitignan mismo yung size, yung texture, the color, consistency, and other imperfection. So the process variables such as the head space, fill width, drain width, etc. So kasama dyan. So for example, kung kayo ay nasa quality assurance, and nandun kayo sa line na i-inspect nyo po yung kung gaanong kadaming juice ang nakalagay sa isang jar o sa isang lalagyan. Unless walang machine na gumagawa is kailangan nyong malaman yung headspace. No? So, kung gaanong kalayo, headspace is the, kasama po yan sa ating worksheet. No? Yung si headspace. So, it is the space in between the lid of the jar, yung nasa dulo ng jar, and the food item itself, no? So, yun yung head space. So, for example po, I have water here. So, let's just say ito, no? So, sabi ang head space ay ito po. No? So, from the top, lid, and then kung ilan yung laman. So, pwede tayo mag-inspection through that. What else? The fill weight. The fill weight is kung gano'ng kadami nakalagay. So, through physical inspection, pag may mga machine, makikita nyo, okay, hanggang 35 grams lang pwede to, pero 50 grams yun na ilagay. So, pwede nyo po yung bawasan. No? And drain weight, and marami pang iba. Okay, next is chemical method. Of course, it is using chemicals. So, ito ay quantitative values ang lumalabas. So, for example, nagawa na po natin to, no? Yung sa research. I'm not sure if kayo yung class na yon na nadala ko. Pero, using pH meter, you may find the pH of the food item. Acidity determination, moisture content, enzyme concentration, and marami pang iba, no? So, iba't iba yung test na makikita natin, and we will be discussing it throughout the semester. Okay, next is we have microscopy method. So, ito use of knowledge in microbiology to study the sample. We have two categories. We have adulteration para matest kung there is a contamination or adulteration. And the second is if there is a difference between cell, tissues, and microorganism types. Okay? So, si adulteration, kay adulteration, dito, sa microscopy method, pwede nating ma-indicate kung meron bang presence ng bacteria. Kung may presence ba ng yeast, ng mold, or meron bang insect fragments or any foreign materials, malalaman, no? So, I know through your food microbiology and general microbiology, you were taught by Ma'am Sherilyn Aguilera or Sir Jetro for these types, kung anong method ang gagawin nyo to test those. And then, we also have we use microscopy method in differentiation between cell types and tissue types and microorganisms. So, ito yung tinetest natin yung mismong sample or yung tissue of a stored food wherein microorganism is present that may cause spoilage or undesirable fermentation changes. So dito meron na mismo nung sample ng food, no? So yan. So now we will discuss just a brief run through of ano ba, what is total quality management. So total quality management, ito yung process of managing quality to maximize the productivity and also to minimize costs, which is basically ang total quality management, it's a principle na kailangan ma-satisfy yung ating customers. What else? Total quality management, it is a structured system for overall quality assurance. It is a continuous process. So again, this word is very important. Continuous process. Kasi hindi lang basta sa development of the QA, but also sa improvement and even sa maintenance. So, TQM involves everybody dealing with the product. So, lahat ng deal with the product in manufacturing, may it be directly or indirectly. So, when we say directly or indirectly, either you are handling the food or not, kasama pa rin ang TQM dyan, no? So, si TQM, we have the subsystem. So, ibig sabihin, ito yung lahat ng functions in the life cycle of a product. From design of the product, from the planning itself, we have the production mismo, distribution, and up until the field service, kasama ang TQM. So, ISO 9000, if CTQM is a philosophy of continuous improvement, so this is an important term, continuous improvement, then ISO 9000 is a quality system management standard, no? So again, CTQM is a principle, and then si ISO 9000, ito yung mismong standard na tinatawag natin. Okay, it sets in the system to deploy policy and verifiable objectives. So when we say verifiable objectives, so ito ay SMART, no? It's yung specific, measurable, attainable. What else? R is relevant, and of course, time-bound yung T, no? Sa objectives. Okay, so we have several statistical tools that we use in TQM. So kumbaga ito yung mga basis na ginagamit na tools. So first we have data sheet, cause and effect diagram, scatter diagram, flow chart, Pareto chart, histogram, and control chart. So, itong mga to, you will encounter this during mismong observation sa isang food company. Okay, so first, we have the data sheet. No? So, data sheet. Dito ko nilalagay si camera. Okay, so si data sheet, it is a data from a table, table form. And it may be in a query or view or stored procedure displayed in a row and column format. So, madaling tandaan si datasheet kasi present si rows. So, when we say rows, ano, yung pag-ganon po siya horizontally. And columns yung nakatayo. So, this is an example of a datasheet. So, makikita nyo po dyan. So, meron tayong sample weekly inventory spreadsheet. So, nakalagay po dyan, for example, yung kung anong group. So, meat, seafood, description niya. Ito by ground beef, anong type ng salmon. What else? Unit of measurement, kung ilan yung unit price niya and ilan yung total etc. No? So, ganyan ang example ng isang inventory spreadsheet. Okay. Next, we have a cause and effect diagram. So, cause and effect diagram, it is designed by a Japanese, important Japanese person, no? Si Mr. Kaoru Ishikawa. So, Kaoru Ishikawa, siya ay isa sa mga pioneer na nag-program ng TQM. Actually, ang TQM is a collaboration between American and Japanese companies. Okay? Okay, so dito sa cause and effect diagram, yung causes natin are arranged into four most common major categories. So, ganito ang itsura ng ating cause and effect diagram. So, mukha siyang fishbone, ano? Buto ng isda. So, for manufacturing, yung four major categories na ginagamit po dyan is manpower, methods, materials, and machinery. So, sa pagdating naman sa administration and planning, yung causes na common category are equipment, policies, procedures, and people. So, again, it is called as a fishbone diagram. So, makikita nyo, this is an example of a manufacturing na cause and effect diagram. So, nandito yung problem or yung effect, and then nakalagay po dito yung four major categories, which is yung manpower natin. We have the machine, we have the material, and we also have the method. No? So, for example, meron tayong example po dito ng isang cause and effect diagram. Okay. So, here, ang problem ay meron tayong bad coffee. No? So, hindi maganda siguro yung depende. No? So, yun yung pinakang problem. And now, we have the four categories. We have manpower or service. So, sa manpower, ang problem, ang cause kung bakit nagkakaroon ng bad coffee, possible there is a bad service, providing bad service. Ano pa? It is also possible na pagdating sa manpower, walang training yung personnel kung paano gumawa ng kape, paano ba gumawa talaga ng caramel macchiato o ng espresso. So, yan. What else? Pagdating sa material, so ito naman, no? So, material, possible na yung coffee brand ay hindi maganda o kaya pwede rin na expired na yung ating coffee. Pwedeng bad yung sweetener, hindi maganda yung sweetener na nagamit. Hindi okay yung cream na ginamit, yung milk, spoiled na, and so on. Okay, pagdating sa methods or procedures, so pag methods, or procedures kung paano gawin, ano? So, maybe yung personnel, naglagay siya, too much water ang nakalagay sa coffee. Pwede rin na yung brewing masyadong matagal. Pwede rin masyadong madaming coffee nilagay. Pwede nyo rin dyan ilagay masyadong maraming sugar, masyadong maraming cream, etc. So, pagdating naman po sa machinery or equipment, anong mga possible na causes. So, pwedeng madumi yung cups, dirty cups. Pwedeng mali yung size ng filter. Possible din na yung coffee machine niya, it's not working properly. Ano pang example ng machinery and equipment na problem? Maybe hindi nahuhugasan yung mga equipment na ginagamit. No? So, may kalakalawang na. So, pwede nyong ilagay yan. You can be detailed as much as possible. So, ayan. Okay? So, yan ang example ng cause and effect diagram. Okay? So, next, we have another tool. So this is a scatter diagram or chart. So kung makikita nyo naman po sa picture, so i-move ko ito, no? So kung makikita nyo po dyan, it is almost similar to a line graph, except that the data points are plotted without connecting line drawn between them. So walang linya, no? And there should be at least two measured objects are needed for the query. So kailangan at least may dalawa. So kung makikita nyo, ganyan po ang itsura ng scatter diagram. So this is an example ng product concentration po, yung nandito sa x-axis natin. And then sa y-axis is kung ganong ka-acid yung, ganong kadaming acid yung nilagay. So ayan, so the more na tumataas yung concentration, dumadami din yung acid na i-add sa product. So yan. Makikita yung trend. Okay, so it also in scatter diagram or chart, it is used to study possible relationships between two variables. And also makikita nyo dyan, what happens to one variable when the other variable is changed. So tulad nga nung sinabi ko kanina, no, so dito for example, let's just say ang nasa x-axis natin is kung ganong kadami yung ating sauce, or let's just say this is water, no, tapos sa y-axis natin is kung gaano kadaming sugar yung ilalagay. So let's just say magbago yung concentration ng ating sugar. So anong mangyayari kaya pag binago yon, no, in relation to ml volume ng liquid. So yan. Okay, next type of tool is what we call the flow chart. So ito very familiar kayo dyan kasi makikita nyo yung tawag dito, yung process, no, kung paano nangyayari. So flow chart, it is a graphic representation. So meron tayong standard icons such as blocks. So nakapaloob siya sa blocks. And it is excellent for process operation or yung step-by-step na decisions or even actions. I will show you an example later. It also uses arrows to show where the process leads. So for example, this is a simple flow chart na ginagamit. So for this is flow diagram ng food, no? From purchasing to receiving and storage. And then next is we have the preparation. After mo mag-prepare, we have mixing, cooking, and then cooling. Minsan, yung sa cooling natin, either it can go to waste. Or diretso siya sa packaging, rework, and then i-store ulit siya. Or after packaging, pwedeng i-dispatch na. So, this is just a simple flowchart. Meron tayong example ng mga complicated or complex na flowchart. So, let me zoom this in for you. So, this is an example of how do you want your coffee, no? So, since coffee naman yung pinag-uusapan natin kanina. So, for example, do you want your coffee to be brewed today? So, yes or no? So, pag yes or no, do you prefer milk in your coffee? So, pag yes, meron ka bang espresso machine? So, kung wala, isa siyang tatawagin nating bialetti. So, pag wala ka na, yes, meron kang espresso machine, gusto mo bang isa ba siyang flat white or gusto mo ba latte siya, cappuccino, french press ba ang gagamitin natin or clever dipper, etc., etc. So this is an example of complicated na process ng ating coffee, no? Example ng flowchart. Okay, next we have another statistical tool. So this one naman ay tinatawag na Pareto chart. So si Pareto chart siya ay nagpasimula na isang principle that 80% of problems come from 20% of the equipment or galing sa workforce. So ibig sabihin ang dito sa Pareto chart, ina-answer niya yung mga questions such as, what are the largest issues facing a team or business? Or, ano yung 20% of sources na nagkokos nung 80% ng problem, which is the 80-20 rule? So, tandaan nyo yung 80-20 sa kay Pareto chart. Anong effort should be focused on to achieve the greatest improvement? So, this is an example of a Pareto chart. So, each bar na yan is represented by a problem, siguro, no? Or, it can be represented by any group. So, dito, halimbawa, what 20% of sources ang nagkakos ng problem? So, makikita na agad dyan, okay, so, ito palang unang bar na to ang nagkakos ng problem natin. So, automatic, madaling makita si problem kay Pareto chart. Okay, next type of statistical analysis tool is a histogram. So, si histogram naman, it is used to graphically summarize and display the distribution of process data set. So, kung makikita nyo po dyan, for example, dito ay si pH. Okay, so here is a pH distribution ng tomato sauce, no? So dito, it answers the question, what is the most common system response or what distribution do the data have? Yung center niya, variation niya, at iba pa. So dito makikita nyo kung ganong kadami yung sample in y-axis. And we also have sa x-axis, makikita nyo dyan yung pH level. So, dito, depende sa sample. So, for example, dito, etong mga bars na to are represented by kung groups ng batches siguro to, no? So, for the first batch, ang pH niya ay, so, dapat ito yung mga nasa around 4.1 to 4.5. So, ibig sabihin si tomato sauce is, ito dapat yung magiging pH niya, no? Sa production. Okay? So, next, another statistical tool is a control chart. So, it displays quality characteristics that has been measured or computed from a sample versus the sample number or time. So, dito sa control chart, makikita nyo po dyan ang presence ni upper limit. So, ito si upper control limit. Yun na, sa 7. We also have lower control limit. Ito yon, yun na sa baba, which is sa nasa 5. And we have the center control line. Ay, actually, ito pala, lower control limit and upper control limit sa 6 and 7, sorry. So, makikita nyo dyan, yun na yung sa gitna na yon is the center control limit. So, ibig sabihin po nito, within this upper and lower control, as long as the points plot within the control limits, the process is assumed to be in control or no action is necessary. So, pag ganyan po ang lumabas sa chart nyo, ibig sabihin, okay yung production nyo. No? Kasi within those limits. Pero pag lumampas po dyan, maraming lumampas dyan, you will know na may problema pala pagdating sa production line. Okay? So, makikita rin po dito, for example, ay ito ay time, yun nasa x-axis. So, for example, nung around 11 p.m., let's just say ito 8 a.m., Pagdating nung 8 a.m., yung net weight, kung gano'ng kadami yung pinoproduce, control, maunti yung na-produce, ano? Compared nyo with around 2:30, 3 p.m., makikita dito na madami yung na-produce na food, ano? So, yan. So, again, they contain upper and lower control limits within which all observations will lie if the process is under the control. They contain a center line which is usually considered the target value. So, yun yung target. So, dito sa control chart, so, pag nasa gitna, ibig sabihin yun po yung target, ano. And then, they generally show numbers along the vertical axis to define the values of the control limits and observation. So, this is just an example. Marami pang pwedeng lumabas ng type of control chart. Depende sa hinahanap. Na? So, other types of charts which are, you are, I'm sure, very much familiar with. So, we have the bar chart. So, ganyan ang example. So, this is an example of a bar chart na pinapakita yung daily production. So, for example, dito ay production by line. So, meron tayong ditong line A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So, ito ay nagre-represent. For example, si line A, ang pinuproduce niya ay, halimbawa, siya yung gumagawa ng sauce. Si line B, pwedeng dito, siya yung nagmi-mix ng final sauce. And then, pwedeng hanggang, depende kung ano yung ginagawa sa processing, no? So, yan. So, daily production. And then, makikita rin dito kung ganong kadami yung nagagawa. So, ibig sabihin si dito sa bar chart na to, if we will interpret this, si line E ang may pinakang mataas na production compared with line A, line C, and line F, no? Na medyo mababa yung production. Okay, so next is pie chart, another example. So here, they do not show changes over time. Pie chart should not include more than 8. So dapat hindi madami, no? More than 8 yung segments. And each segment should be labeled with percentages of absolute amounts. So, kailangan mag-total ito ng sa isang bilog ay 100%. So, kung makikita nyo dito, again, represented by a legend, yung ating line, line A, B hanggang F. And as you can see, itong 22% na ito, pinakamataas, 22% ng production ay ginagawa ni line B, ano? So, yan. And then, ang pinakamababang production ay si, ito pong 13%. So, siguro ito ay si line F or line, siguro ito ay line F, yan, no? Mas maganda kasi sana kung color coding para mas madaling makita. So, yan si pie chart. Okay, another is a spider chart. So, kung makikita nyo, mukha naman siyang spider. So, si spider chart, it graphically display the performance of multiple variables on a single page providing easy to read data. So, for example, dito ang pinapakita ay the performance nga. So, dito ay makikita sa timeliness. So, mataas, no? Pag kasi nandito na siya halos sa dulo. So, okay. So, pasok sa time. Pagdating sa quality, pasok din. And then, pagdating sa service and partnership, medyo mababa. Ito ang isang problem, makikita nyo na agad. Meron bang efficient data collection? And pagdating sa electric commerce, medyo mahina, ano? So, yan yung interpretation niya. And then, pagdating sa quality or work environment, kasama sa leadership management and professional workforce, sakto lang. Okay? So, ganong kadaling i-interpret pagdating sa kay spider chart. Ay, okay. Bakit naligaw to? Anyway, so you will have a lab worksheet. Nagagawa kayo ng data sheet, flow chart, and cause and effect diagram, which I will explain later. But we will still continue with last na itong part na ito, which is a management and planning tools. So ito yung ginagamit ng pagdating sa mga administrative no, na work. So we have affinity diagram. So it sorry po, natatakpan pala. Okay, so we have affinity diagram or also called as KJ method or Kawakita-Jiro method, KJ. So, it breaks an operation down into categories and it is similar to use in operational analysis except na dito sa affinity diagram, group similar items together instead na nakalist into chronological sequence. So, example ng affinity diagram po natin ay ito. Teka po, i-move ko ito. Ano? Okay, so this is an example of affinity diagram. So, madalas itong makikita sa mga saan ba? Usually sa mga government na departments. So, makikita dyan for example ito. Customer sa manufacturing a successful product. So una, meron tayong categories, no? Itong mga nasa taas, these are each categories. And then under niya nakalista kung ano yung mga dapat meron under each category. So for example, dito sa customer requirements, kailangan ma-identify mo yung customer, kailangan makapag-consult ka sa customer. Kailangan maintindihan mo at ma-interpret mo yung customer requirement. Kailangan makapag-provide ka ng technical definition of requirement, etc. So, halimbawa dito naman sa personnel training. So, kailangan daw merong training in quality improvement tools, makapag-establish ng cross-training program, and continuous improvement of opportunities. So, ganyan, ano? So, madaling tandaan si affinity diagram. Kasi, again nga, ang kailangan nyo ditong matandaan is, it nag-group siya ng similar items together, no? Instead na hindi siya naka-chronological sequence compared kay flowchart. So, ganyan si affinity diagram. Okay, another is we have tree diagram. Okay, move ko dito. Okay, so sa tree diagram, ito ay systematic diagram or dendrogram. Pwede siyang tawagin. So, bakit? So, dito, it's a technique for mapping out full range of paths and tasks that need to be done in order to achieve a primary goal and related sub-goals. So, kung babasahin po itong tree diagram natin, from left to right, so, from here hanggang makarating ka sa right side, ina-answer niya yung question na how to accomplish, no? And then, from right to left naman, kung babasahin niyo po pabalik, ia-answer niya yung question na why. So, bakit? Kasi nandito yung pinakang goal. No? So, yan ang example. So, mukha rin siyang flowchart. The difference is that dito this is goals ang or related sub-goals yung ating pinapakita. Okay, so this is another example. Another type ng tools na sa management is a matrix diagram. So sa matrix diagram, makikita po natin dito are the factors to compare. At saka, sinashow niya yung relationship between two or more sets. So, meron tayong column and rows here. And pag na-intersect po siya sa isa't isa, malalaman natin yung nature and strength of the problem. So, ayan, ano? So, for example here, ayan, nakikita yung rate, the presence and strength of relationship between two or more sets of information. So, for example here, ang ating problem ay saan tayo pupunta ng bakasyon, no? So, where to go on a vacation? So, meron dito Disneyland, Grand Canyon, pupunta ba tayo sa Hawaii, sa Yellowstone Park, sa Mexico? So, ito yung ibang factors. Ganong kadami yung, katagal yung time travel? Is it fun for everyone? Ganong kadaming clothing ang kailangan? Pagdating sa cost, ano bang total cost? And then, dito, yung total. So, parang merong scoring system pagdating sa matrix. And then, at the end, makikita nyo po kung ano yung result. No? So, for example, here, sa Cancun, Mexico. So, sa mga tuwid, to summarize, pinakamataas na score na nakuha si Cancun, Mexico. No? So, based from this factor. So, ganun din dito. So, pwede tayong magawa ng example po nito sa food processing. So, usually, ito maganda siyang iano pagdating sa thesis nyo, yung matrix diagram. Okay, here is example of a Gantt chart. So, ito ay may time frame. So, ito usually ginagamit din sa mga thesis. No? So, kasi it shows a planned work and finished work in relation to time. So, kung makikita nyo po dyan, kung izo-zoom ko ito, so, makikita nyo po dyan ang goal ng January, February, and so on. Depende sa inyo. Pwede nyo gawing mas detailed by showing the dates. So, for example here, eto, no? So, para makapag-design ng test stand, so, ginawa niya ng January 12 hanggang January 27. Ah, tama ba? January 14. So, nakalagay dyan specific 114 and 127. So, ayan. So, through Gantt chart, makikita kung ano yung progress ng isang process. No? Which is really good. Pagdating sa thesis, this is very helpful. So, kasi i-enumerate nyo yung task and then i-plot nyo lang kung kailan nyo siya ginawa. Okay, so finally, this is your lab worksheet. So, sa lab worksheet po natin, gagawa tayo ng tatlo. We have data sheet, flow chart, and the cause and effect diagram. So, sa data sheet, basically po, bibigyan ko kayo ng food products. So, for those who attended my previous online class, you were already assigned a food product. And for those na wala pang food product, bibigyan ko po kayo, no? I will, please approach me para mabigyan kayo. So, your lab worksheet, this will be your activity for week number 6, which is next week. So, yun po yung activity yung next week. Okay, so for example, ang food product natin is pandesal. You have to list down all the ingredients. So, gagamit tayong flour, malunggay, margarine, egg, salt, sugar. For quantity, ilagay nyo lang dyan. So, pwede kayo mag-search sa internet ng ingredients. And then, of course, kailangan din kayo maglagay ng description. So, for example, sa flour, so, siya ay bread flour, class A, fine. Sa malunggay, kailangan siya ay finely chopped and fresh. O, pwede nyo gawing dried malunggay. So, margarine, star yung gagamitin na brand. So, for egg, dapat ito ay jumbo or extra large. Sa salt, iodized ang salt. Sa sugar, white and refined. So, ganyan ang example ng description for data sheet. No? Okay, next. Gagawa rin po kayo ng flowchart. So, yung process kung paano gawin yung food product, kailangan nyo maging super detailed dito. No? So, for example, sa pandesal, from, pagkuha pa lang ng ingredients. So, halimbawa, una nyong gagawin is sift flour. So, ito ay parang step-by-step process kung paano gagawin. What else? Kailangan yung malunggay, i-chop nyo. So, kasama yan. Kasama yung mixing of wet ingredients. And then, you have to add the dry ingredients. And then, pagmamasa, pagkakat nung pandesal. What else? Pag-oven ng pandesal, kung ganong katagal ba. So, yan. Ano? So, depende sa magiging food product na naka-assign sa inyo. Okay, next activity is gagawa rin po kayo ng cause and effect diagram. So, think of any possible problem that your food product may have and trace the causes using a fishbone diagram. So, for example, yung kanina, so, bad coffee, no? So, ibig sabihin, hindi okay yung coffee. So, using the four main categories of manpower, methods, materials, and machinery or equipment. So, ilagay nyo po doon. Kailangan mas madami pa doon. Kasi, yung coffee, yung example po natin kanina, is just a very simple food product. So, dito, kailangan mas marami kayong mailistang causes. Okay, so, thank you for listening. And, these are the references that I used. So, along with this, no? So, with that, thank you, and I'll see you again on our next lecture.